For some narcissists, they can learn compassion. For others, it's a recognition, wow, I struggle with feeling that or even caring about other people except for what they can give to me. He deals with feeling like he's in Thor's shadow by just raising a ton of hell.
That little wheeze at the end. Oh my gosh. Welcome to Cinema Therapy, or today, Villain Therapy.
Dun dun dun.
Where we look at a villain from cinema, and our resident therapist figures out whether or not therapy could have helped prevent that villain from villainization.
I'm Jonathan Decker. I am that licensed therapist. This is
Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker, and I need therapy.
And so today we're looking at who?
God of Mischief.
Loki.
Loki.
Surprise.
And we want to be very clear here. So this is two sides of a coin because we also have another series called Hero Psychology.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is to normalize both our heroes and our villains oftentimes need help.
Get help, please. My brother is dying. Get help. Help him. Classic.
So first, let's dive into Loki's history. What is this man's history?
So he was born a little baby blue icicle.
A little blue baby icicle.
I love Thor Ragnarok so much. Taken from his homeworld by Odin, raised as Odin's own son, has no memory, actually, of being
a little blue baby icicle.
And Thor's brother, raised for thousands of years, he's an Asgardian, always feels like he's in Thor's shadow.
Yeah.
There's some not great parenting going on there, being compared to his brother.
Oh yeah, yeah,
there's,
for sure.
There's some issues. Fights wars with his brother. There's obvious sibling rivalry, but there's also obvious sibling love and affection.
Loki, I thought the world of you. I thought we were gonna fight side by side forever, but at the end of the day, you're you and I'm me.
He's got an interesting backstory.
He's got so much going on, and he deals with feeling like he's in Thor's shadow by just raising a ton of hell.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So let's take a look at this.
Can I just give a quick FYI?
I was just talking to him just a couple of minutes ago, and he was totally ready to kill any of us.
He did try to kill me.
Yes, me too, on many, many occasions. He transformed himself into a snake, and he knows that I love snakes. So I went to pick up the snake to admire it, and he transformed back into himself, and he was like, yeah, it's me. And he stabbed me.
If we're boosting his ship, we're gonna.
And his little grin! He's just like, oh yeah. I remember that time.
That's a good memory.
Just stabbing my brother.
But so here's a question. And I like your thoughts on this, and I'll share mine.
Yeah.
Nature versus nurture.
Sure.
Right? The whole concept of nature versus nurture is who you are. Is it determined by what's in you genetically that you inherit from your bloodline? You know, certain traits, certain attributes, certain personality styles. Or is it nurture? Is it your environment, the people you're surrounded by, the experiences that you have? Now, a lot of people land on it's both.
Sure.
But we see something with Loki here. He didn't come from Odin and Frigga's family.
Right.
Right? So he has frost giant blood in him. There's no mischief in that Asgardian castle except for him.
Right, yeah. Thor, not particularly mischievous.
You dare threaten me, Thor, with so puny a weapon.
What do you think? Do you think Loki's mischief is a result of his bloodline, or do you see it as this is how I'm responding to being in Thor's shadow?
That one's tough to tell.
And his constant grandstanding, like I need to take him down a notch.
Yeah. It's tough to like pick a side on that, whether it's nature or nurture or, you know, a combination, because, you know, obviously he does come from a different place, but he didn't know that.
Yeah.
He has a completely different power set than Thor does. You know, he's a magician, he's a wizard, he can shapeshift, he can do, you know, illusions and stuff, which lends itself to his sort of trickster persona.
Yeah, use what you got, right?
So. Yeah, and if what you got can let you turn into a snake and then stab your brother, like, do it.
So that would be the nature side, like, he's definitely got this skill set that comes genetically.
Right. There's an argument to be had for nature there, but with nurture, you know, there's also the obvious, you know, Odin comparing him to Thor.
Thor, Odin's son, my heir, my firstborn.
That's what makes this character so interesting, is you can't really pick.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we can have this debate about it.
We could, and I'm not going to say I'm the therapist, so here's what happened. I'll give my opinion. My opinion is I think the mischief was probably always in him. The natural aptitude for the shape-shifting and creating illusions and things like that. And so, but I think the nastiness of it...
Right.
Comes from family dynamics. I think Loki probably turning into a snake and scaring Thor was always going to happen. Stabbing Thor is probably a result of dad loves you more.
Sure.
You know, you're going to be the heir to the throne. I just really hate your stinking guts.
All this because Loki desires a throne.
It is my birthright.
Your birthright was to die.
And then what's fun, we talk about in our Prince of Egypt episode that hate comes from love. Right? And the concept of we only hate people if we first loved them or if they threatened somebody that we loved or if someone that we loved taught us to hate them. That's mm-hmm. that's generally what happens. There could be other reasons we hate, but a lot of it is tied to love. We see so much evidence that Loki loves Thor and absolutely hates his guts.
Oh, yeah.
And that's why that whole moment when he's like, it varies from moment to moment what I'm up to.
So, last time I saw you, you were trying to kill everybody. Where are you at these days?
It varies from moment to moment.
Loki's a total mood, you know? He's just, whatever he's feeling, he's gonna do.
Yep.
But he has this moment here where he discovers the truth of his heritage, and he realizes that he's adopted. And let's see what happens, because this has been covered up to him for millennia.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't go particularly well.
In the aftermath of the battle, I went into the temple, and I found a baby. Small for a giant's offspring, abandoned, suffering, left to die, Laufey's son.
Laufey's son?
Yes.
Why? You were knee-deep in Jotun blood. Why would you take me?
You were an innocent child.
No. You took me for a purpose. What was it? Tell me!
Hiddleston's so good.
I thought we could unite our kingdoms one day, bring about an alliance, bring about a permanent peace through you. But those plans no longer matter.
So I am no more than another stolen relic, locked up. Here until you might have use of me.
Why do you twist my words?
You could have told me what I was from the beginning. Why didn't you?
You're my son. I wanted only to protect you from the truth.
What? Because I'm the monster parents tell their children about at night? You know, it all makes sense now. Why you favored Thor all these years. Because no matter how much you claim to love me, you could never have a frost giant sitting on the throne of Asgard.
That scene is so powerful. And if you think about it, if you know, you take it out of the context of the film, what Tom Hiddleston and Anthony Hopkins are doing there is delivering sort of big over-the-top lines in very silly costumes, in kind of a silly looking set. It's so much larger than life that when you're doing it on camera, it's gonna feel weird. So what they're doing is on set incredibly silly, but these two actors are such pros, and they're being directed by such a pro. Kenneth Branagh bringing that Shakespearean, you know, thunder. Thunder, get it?
Nice. Yeah. Well played.
Thor.
I love how you have to explain it. It's a Thor reference.
That's
you see,
what
it's
happened.
Funny because he's the god of thunder.
We are laughing.
That's what happened, Brian Regan. You know, they're being helped by the score there. Obviously, you know, the lighting, the set is beautiful and everything, but it's a very simple scene, the way it's shot. It's just coverage on both of them. If the camera's moving, it's very subtly. It's not big and flashy. It's the best special effect. Two actors going at it.
Yeah. And this scene really speaks to me clinically how often parents keep secrets from their kids.
Yeah.
Right, especially if there's been something hard. This is super relatable, the adoption one. I've actually worked with quite a few families where they have an adopted child and they decide not to tell the child because they want the child to feel like they're not different, they're just part of the family. And then that completely backfires.
Yeah, does that ever go well?
I've never seen it go well.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so.
I mean, it's adoption, but there's a host of other things where we think, well, kids aren't ready. And it's just like what Odin said, I wanted only to protect you from the truth. And the same thing always happens. I'm afraid of telling them that I haven't been honest with them because we've got a great bond now. And if they find out that I was lying or concealing, then they won't trust me.
He kept the truth from you so that you would never feel different. You are our son, Loki, and we your family.
And so they keep procrastinating telling the truth. In this case, for like millennia.
Yeah, it's a long time.
It's a long, long time. My opinion is it's always far better to tell kids the truth. And you may need to put it at their level, and there may be layers of it that come as they get older. Mm-hmm. If Loki had known from the beginning where he came from and who he was, and that his old home wasn't safe, and that he was safe and loved and family in this home, this moment would not have happened. And frankly, most of Loki's MCU arc wouldn't have happened.
Yeah, it would have made for terrible films, but a much happier family.
Yeah, exactly.
Nobody wants to watch a movie of Thor and Loki just getting along and being bros.
I would, but I'm weird like that.
Well, if they have something else to fight. But right. I mean, what do you do with this movie where Loki's the villain?
Oh, no, I get it. It's fantastic drama. I'm just saying in real life. So how do you see a shift in Loki's attitude towards his family after this?
I'm not sure that there's a huge shift in the actual attitude. I think there's a shift in his perception of what his attitude is. Mm. I think he was already always pushing boundaries and doing things, and he's instigating problems and causing trouble. He's the god of mischief.
Yeah.
Long before this.
Yeah.
After this, I think he acknowledges like, yeah, okay, all that stuff is fine and I'm just going to push it even further.
Yeah. And I think he always wanted the throne, but he was probably willing to reluctantly, unhappily yield it to Thor and just be like, ugh, I hate my life. But now after this, he's like, screw this.
I'm just taking it.
Yeah, I'm just taking it. Odin's a liar. Frigga kept it from me. Thor's an idiot. And then he goes so far into being even more hurtful than he's ever been.
Yeah.
To the point where Thor is outcast and Loki makes no attempt to help him back. In fact, he says,
let me explain to Father.
Father is dead.
Father's dead. Mother doesn't want you back. And that is such a heartbreaking, well-acted scene. I especially love when Chris Hemsworth says,
thank you for coming here.
And so Loki, of course, at this point, believes, as he's always believed, I am special, I am awesome, I deserve the throne. And when he doesn't get it, in my mind, Asgard is no longer home to him.
Right.
So he goes to Earth, and he's going to try and set up shop. Let's see what happens.
Kneel before me. I said, is not this simpler? Is this not your natural state? It's the unspoken truth of humanity that you crave subjugation. The bright lure of freedom diminishes your life's joy in a mad scramble for power, for identity. You were made to be ruled. In the end, you will always kneel.
I love this.
Not to men like you.
There are no men like me.
There are always men like you.
Oh.
Look to your elder people. Let him be an example.
And of course, we know what happens.
Captain America has a disagreement with him.
You know, the last time I was in Germany
and saw a man standing above everybody else, we ended up disagreeing.
The soldier.
Now, if you're enjoying this episode of Villain Therapy, we've got another one you're going to want to check out. Joker, starring Joaquin Phoenix. We really break him down, how he gets from point A to point crazy, and that's a lot of fun.
Is he treatable?
Find out right here.
You'll have to watch the episode.
Do it.
Do it.
do it.
Before we go into Loki, can we talk about that moment with the old German man?
Yeah.
Why does that make me feel things?
It's because he completely unpacks and demolishes a tyrannical argument with six words.
There are always men like you.
Six words and a facial expression.
Yeah.
You know, it's that mixture of revulsion and pity.
Yeah.
Of like, you think you're this big, powerful thing, but there's always men like you.
Loki thinks, genuinely believes he is superior.
Right.
And that his rightful position is a benevolent god.
Sure.
And what I love about the writing is Loki actually believes humanity will be better off with me. In his mind, it's not just about his ego. This is, I'm doing this for all of you people.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and he absolutely believes what he's saying. But here we see not just arrogance, something much higher than arrogance, something much more than arrogance. But Loki truly assumes, I am deserving of recognition. I am deserving of power and praise. And if we all did things my way, we'd be okay.
Right.
We really start to see in the Avengers, even more than in the first Thor film, is...
Is it still in?
I think I broke a rib.
Is just how arrogant Loki is.
Mm-hmm.
And vain. So, of course, setting up all that arrogance for an entire film leads us to our favorite, a lot of people's favorite Loki moment.
I got him.
The little smirk.
I am a god, you dull creature, and I will not be bullied by him.
Puny god. Okay, best part of the whole scene. That little wheeze at the end. Oh my gosh.
Why do we love seeing the piss taken out of this character? Because it happens throughout the whole series.
It happens constantly throughout the whole series. It's because we love seeing, you know, vainglorious people brought low. Like, that's just part of the human condition. It's like, you think you're special? Hulk will show you something.
Yeah.
It's the setups and payoffs, especially with Loki, because it's so easy to build him up, because he's a god. He's incredibly powerful. He's very smart. He's very tricky. So anytime you can slap him around like a wet rag, you do it.
So of course he's defeated, he's taken back to Asgard, and he's imprisoned. But Thor the Dark World, I don't think is anybody's favorite Marvel movie.
No.
But there's some really interesting Loki stuff in there, especially after Frigga dies and Thor comes to visit him. Mm-hmm. And it looks like he's just in there normal. And then he drops the illusion, and we see that he's just a wreck.
Yeah.
And Thor needs his help, and he says, I wish I could trust you. And Loki says,
trust my rage.
And throughout Thor the Dark World, I mean, throughout the series, Loki continually underestimates his brother, thinks of him as just an idiot. Which...
Just a big, muscle-bound dummy.
That's what... Because that's what heroes do.
Which sets up some more humbling moments for Loki. He gets humbled a lot throughout the MCU, and it's hard for him to actually learn the lesson.
Yeah.
But throughout that film, he generally does outsmart Thor, landing himself on the throne, impersonating Odin. And that's where we see him at the beginning of Thor Ragnarok, which...
Let's take a look at this.
Oh, man. So this is something I didn't catch.
This is it.
Oh, we'll talk about it in a minute.
You fool, you didn't listen.
I'm sorry.
Lady Sif, get help!
Somebody help!
I love that that's setting up a joke later.
I'm sorry, I tried to rule Earth.
I'd be lucky to have you. Thing with the Tesseract. I just couldn't help myself.
I know.
I'm a trickster.
Yes.
So mischievous.
Sorry about that time I turned you into a frog.
It was a wonderful joke.
It was indeed hilarious.
You are the savior of Asgard.
Tell my story.
I don't know about you, man, but in the theater watching this, I was crying laughing. Like, I almost peed my pants.
I will tell Father what you did here today. You didn't do it for him.
I didn't do it for him.
I love that you pointed out to me that the choir is singing the music from Thor the Dark World.
Yeah, from Frigga's funeral.
Oh my gosh. Sam Neill!
For hours. He fought back those disgusting elves. He brought peace to the realm. Loki, my boy.
It was many moons ago I found you on that frostbitten battlefield. On that day, I did not yet see in you Asgard's savior. No, you were merely a little blue baby icicle that melted this old fool's heart.
Oh my
heart.
Gosh!
Okay, pause.
Father. Oh,
oh yeah.
Okay, Anthony Hopkins playing Loki playing Odin. Damn.
So good.
Who knew he had the comedy chops?
I love that Loki as Odin has set up a play to honor himself.
It's the most Loki thing.
So we've got Sam Neill. We've got one of the Hemsworth brothers, I believe, playing Thor.
Playing Thor.
And then as Loki.
Matt Damon.
Matt Damon.
But he's set up this, he's rewritten history, which is what narcissists do.
Mm-hmm.
Their life is going to reflect well on them, their intentions, everyone sees them as great. So when he's like, I'm sorry, I tried to rule Earth.
They'd be lucky to have you.
You're so mischievous. And this is a moment from Thor the Dark World. This is the moment because Thor believed that Loki was dead, and this is how he died, except for it's completely rewritten. But I love the line in the play because it reveals so much about who Loki wants to be when Sam Neill as Odin talks about Loki being the savior
of Asgard.
Of Asgard.
Yeah.
Loki really, really just wants the admiration, the adulation, and whether he gets it as a benevolent god, as a hero, or as a merciless, you know, conqueror, however he can get it, he just wants to come out on top. So I am ready to make my diagnosis.
Finally!
Let's hear it.
It's pretty obvious. Loki is being diagnosed with narcissistic personality disorder.
Shocker.
That's shocking.
Whoa.
So he's got an inflated sense of self-importance and entitlement. He needs constant admiration and praise. He exaggerates his achievements and talents, which is this play, like straight up this play. He reacts negatively to criticism. He's preoccupied with fantasies about power, success, beauty, takes advantage of others.
Yeah.
He has a hard time recognizing the needs and feelings of other people, and he behaves arrogantly. So a lot of narcissists, like you have to be 5 for 9. He is 9 for 9.
He's 100%. Batting 1,000.
Yeah.
You did it.
Well done, Loki. Well done. So the question is there hope for narcissists?
You know, absolutely.
We've done other episodes on narcissists, and we've actually had people in the comments saying, I've been diagnosed, and I feel like it's hopeless.
Yeah.
So yes, there is. Let's talk about what that looks like.
We have social medias, @therapy_cinema on Twitter and Instagram, r/cinema_therapy on Reddit.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're on Facebook.
We're on Facebook, Twitter. We're all over, baby.
We're on that, the internet.
The thing that means the most to us is when you share these episodes with your friends, we can't grow without you. Well, we can. The algorithm does stuff. But you're better than the algorithm. You just are. We need you.
You're better than a robot.
Aww.
So for Loki, I would recommend both individual therapy and family therapy.
That makes sense.
Yeah, he needs both. Individual therapy to challenge his self-perceptions about his superiority, mm-hmm. about the inferiority of others, and family therapy to help him work through his rage about being lied to.
Mm-hmm.
Because all rage, all anger, it comes from another emotion.
Right.
In Loki's sense, it's hurt, it's betrayal, and he actually needs to learn to express it as hurt and betrayal instead of rage or instead of manipulation or instead of turning into a snake and then stabbing somebody. Right? There are better ways to handle all of this. And even then, it's hard. But I've met people who have narcissistic personality disorder, and if they're aware of it and they want to work on it, things can get better.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It is hard. But what's beautiful about Thor Ragnarok and then into Avengers Infinity War, what happens with Loki is ultimately the best course of action for narcissists in real life.
Though I feel they won't make much of a difference.
Loki.
I know I've betrayed you many times before, but this time it's truly nothing personal. The reward for your capture will set me up nicely.
Never one for sentiment, were you?
Easier to let it burn.
I agree.
Underestimating Thor again. Because he's arrogant and he thinks I will always outsmart him.
Oh, that looks painful. Dear brother, becoming predictable. I trust you. You betray me round and round in circles we go. See, Loki, life is about, it's about growth. It's about change. But you seem to just want to...
That's what this show is, growth and change.
I guess what I'm trying to say is that you'll always be the god of mischief. But you could be more. Just put this over here for you. Places to be, so good luck, guys.
So I love that in that scene, Thor is finally just like, I'm just going to kind of be a dick. I'm over it.
Yeah. I've tried over and over to redeem you, and it's not happening.
Yeah.
Well, throughout the entire series, we have seen a back and forth and tug and pull between Loki's love for his family and his desire to fit in with his family, and even in Thor the Dark World, do right by his family.
Absolutely, yeah.
And other times where he's completely willing to throw his family under the bus for his own glory, his own ego, his own vanity.
Mm-hmm.
And here is where Thor actually shows him that he can be both. He can honor his family and do right by his family and receive the glory and adulation of the people by being a hero.
Yeah.
Your savior is here!
He has embraced the hero-savior role, but he's still Loki. He's still a tool about it.
Yeah. Well, and that's... I've heard people say in comments and sections of other places that they didn't buy Loki's turn to being a hero. They didn't think it was earned. I completely disagree, and here's why. He's not being a hero for... genuine reasons.
No, absolutely not.
Like he at the end of his journey is where Thor was at the beginning of his.
Right.
I want praise, I want honor, I want glory, and I want my family to respect and adore me. Right? And that's where Thor started, and it's where Loki ends. Thor comes to realize being a hero isn't about your own glory, it's about doing right. It's about doing right by others and helping people out and using your talents and skills to make a difference and to ease people's suffering. Loki never, ever in the whole series, like right here, he's going to betray Thor and he's like, hey, it's nothing personal. Like, that's the best consolation he can give. Mm-hmm. It's, this is going to suck for you. You're going to be in prison, but you know, I need to be set up nicely. Like Loki, as many narcissists, he lacks compassion.
Right.
And so for some narcissists, like they can learn compassion. For others, it's a recognition, wow, I struggle with feeling that. I have a hard time putting myself in other shoes or even caring about other people except for what they can give to me. But if I at least cognitively recognize this is moral, this is not, then I can start making moral choices. Even if I'm basking in what it means for people to admire me for doing right, even if that's my motivation, at least I'm doing right.
At least I'm doing the right thing.
Yeah.
You can do the right thing for the wrong reasons and the end result is still the right thing got did.
Got done.
English?
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
We see in Infinity War when he wraps up, even more than his own ego, he loves his brother.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful and well played by Hiddleston when he approaches Thanos to try and kill him to save Thor.
Yeah.
I, Loki, Prince of Asgard, Odin's son.
He has accepted who he is, the way he was raised. He's accepted his adoptive father. He is Odin's son. He is Thor's brother. This is what I'm proud of. You know, and he knows, walking up to Thanos, this is a last-ditch effort.
Yeah.
Like, I hope I can win, but I don't think he's planning on succeeding.
Right, and he had the option of trying to manipulate Thanos into using him again so he could stay alive. But instead he goes for what's essentially a suicide mission to try and save his brother.
Yeah. It's just, it's a beautiful conclusion to Loki's story. But this being the MCU, of course, we're releasing this right before the Loki TV show comes out. How, you might ask? He died.
What I like is when we set up alternate timelines, the Loki of that TV series is picking up right after 2012's Avengers.
Yeah.
Right? Because he steals the Tesseract, he disappears, he's starting on a new adventure. Everything that happens after that, from Thor the Dark World to Thor Ragnarok to Avengers Infinity War, that character had his journey.
Yeah.
He's dead, and he died a hero, and he died loving his brother. And even if he never quite mustered compassion for people in general, he did muster enough to put someone before himself, and that was his last act, which I think is beautiful and awesome. There is hope for narcissists. The thing is, it's will they choose to get help?
We are not doing get help.
And will they choose to change? I personally believe almost everybody on the planet can change, can get better, can have a healthier life, a happier life, better relationships, and live a life of integrity. So whether you have a narcissist in your life that you love, or you are that narcissist, if you can learn to balance or teach them to balance, help them to balance their desire for being adored with doing the right thing, you're probably going to be able to land it. But it's not your responsibility to change another person. This is not the first time we've said this on the show. You can love somebody without having them in your life.
Right.
If they're not safe to be in your life. But Loki, fantastic.
Yeah. One of my favorite villains of all time. Really excited for the show.
Yeah, me too. So until next time.
You are all of you beneath me.
Yeah! That's how it feels!
And watch movies.
I have been falling for 30 minutes!
You can handle it from here.
Yes, of course. Thank you very much for your help.
Good luck.
Handle me.
Who are you?
Loki.
You think you're some kind of sorcerer? Don't think for one minute, you second-rate.
All right, bye-bye.